nitrogen cycling, research about nitrogen cycling and our understanding of nitrogen cycling in cropping system is quite old. But the intricacies of different biological processes involved in the release of plant available nitrogen are still being understood, especially in the new cropping system scenario. So this is the reason why this project started, to actually extend some research to understand the various components of nitrogen cycling that makes available nitrogen available to plant. So there are different pools of nitrogen in soil, from soil organic matter, crop residues, components of soil organic matter, microbiology, microbes, and also different pools of available nutrients, say there is ammonia nitrogen or a nitrate nitrogen. And there are four key processes that actually control the amounts in these processes. And it is these process rates and the timing of the process is the one that actually regulates nitrogen availability in a cereal stubble retained systems or stubble retained systems compared to the old style conventional tillage systems or stubble removed systems. Because stubble provides that biological engine for all these processes other than leaching process to conduct. And the factors that influence this process, of course, soil influences, crop type, their crop quality influences, management and season. And of all these biological processes, there are two things that we were interested in. One is the traditionally what you, many of you would have used are using nitrogen mineralization capacity. Most of the times you use a multiplication factor to soil organic carbon level or a total nitrogen and you estimate nitrogen availability. But as we know, management and stubble retention changes the biological processes. Therefore, nitrogen supply potential, which is a composite of a number of different things. So that's the reason why the for this, what we used is because nitrogen is there in all these pools, to follow what happens to nitrogen from cereal crops through the different pools to the next cereal crop is not feasible unless we know or we can specifically identify and measure nitrogen from the stubble. So for this reason, we labeled wheat plant with a stable isotope 15N. So therefore, we can actually track the nitrogen from a cereal crop to through the different pools and next crops. We did that at three different sites, Karunda, which is a mallee sand, and Horsham, heavy clay, and Tamora, which is red burn earth. And these three sites were chosen because they are in different regions, and also they differ in the organic matter levels and microbial biomass as an indicator of microbial properties. And that is clearly visible there. And 2014, we actually labeled this wheat crop with that 15 nitrogen. So we added a 15N labeled urea fertilizer at the three different crops, and we generated this labeled wheat crops. And we followed what happened to that wheat crop for the nitrogen from that wheat crop to the next two seasons. And the seasons varied, the three different regions, and we found, I can show, but the arrows actually show that the Horsham site and Karunda site, Victorian and South Australian sites, experienced 2015 was a drier year compared to the Tamora site. So we not only have three different environments and three different soil types, but we also had varying seasons, which made it our results in a way testing at different things. Not that we were chasing for it, but it was good to have that. So at each site, the 2014, the crop was labeled. At the end of 2014, we carefully collected this labeled wheat stubble. We could only afford to grow a total of 8 square meters at each place, because that costs around 40 grand. So we collected this above ground stubble carefully, and we measured and quantified, and then we put them back in under two different systems, where stubble is left on the surface, and the other one stubble is incorporated in the top 10 centimeters. So two different treatments. And we did that in 2014 December. And we followed nitrogen from then onward. So we followed each time at the beginning of the crop season and at the end of crop season. We measured this N15 in the soil and in the pools and we measured how much N is the next two cereal crops. So first, what happened to the 15 nitrogen we put in? We know that all the nitrogen that you put in, either urea or ammonium, nitrate forms, doesn't go into the crop. There is some fertilizer efficiency variation. What was we found surprising was that the blue part of the pie charts, you can see at the three different sites, the urea nitrogen we put in, only 35% to 45% was taken up by the first crop. So efficiency of fertilizer nitrogen was less than 50%. In a way, it is not new. From different parts of the world, people have shown it. But to see on all three environments, these are well-managed research plots, you know, 2 to 8 square meter plots. Even then, the efficiency was low. Because of, we knew 50% is left approximately, some of it would have been lost, leached, or above, or denitrified. So we actually grew next two wheat crops on the same area, and we measured how much residual N is coming through. And that's what the next two, the red and the green, slice of the pie. And you could see the extra that comes next 2 years is between 2% to 10%. We got more at Horsham because 2015 was a decile 1 year. So one of the main things that came out of that is 50% of N that you're putting it in the crops, is not taken up by the crop, is not taken up by the next two crops. It's either lost one way or other. So therefore, Theresa McBeth with the LIDA group when said, let's look at Cummins. And so she did a similar one in a smaller scale. It's like a 30 centimeter core only of two or three of them. And looked at see how much of that in the first crop that urea N is taken up. She used the same N15 that we used. And you can see blue one is the one that is taken up by the crop. Then they had some sowing time difference, April sowing to May sowing. And you can see again, at least 50% of it is not taken up. So that's one of the things that came out is the fertilizer nitrogen that is applied through fertilizer in all of these stubble retained systems, only around 50% is taken up by the crop, available with the crop. So it's one of the things that you could look at if you are estimating a crop yield based on rainfall that you are forecasting and you know how much nitrogen you need to put in, you probably need to consider the fertilizer end use efficiency as one of the factors. So that's the first component of the results. And these are all in serial stubble retained systems. So we followed what happened to that nitrogen for the next two cereal crops. So 2014, you can see on the left, as I said before, in this case at Karunda, 38% was nitrogen fertilizer use efficiency. Out of that, 25% was in the grain, and rest was in the roots and the shoots. And on the top, you can see we looked at how much nitrogen went in through the stubble was 12 kilograms of nitrogen. So when we measured the nitrogen in the next two cereal crops, you can see the next wheat crop only took up 0.5 to 1 kilogram, depending upon the treatment, of the nitrogen from the cereal stubble that we put in. And out of which 0.4 grams, kilograms was taken out through the grain, and rest was gone back to the second stubble. And the second year, again, it's around a similar amount. So cereal stubble contribution, nitrogen from cereal stubble for the next cereal crop is small proportion. Because nitrogen from cereal stubble is available to the next crop after it goes through, majority of it goes through the microbial turnover processes. The nitrogen has to be taken up by microbes, either during decomposition, whatever, and then the microbes turn over, then the nitrogen is nitrified and mineralized to nitrate, then the crop takes up. Nitrogen leached from cereal stubble contribution is minimal. That's one of the reasons why it takes time, smaller amount comes through. And you will see the results from the other sites, the same thing. So when we went and looked at various things, and you can again go from the left to right, at the end of the first summer fallow, 5% of the stubble nitrogen was actually in the soil. So only 5% of that 12 kilos, so 0.6 kilograms that actually came out of stubble, we could measure in the soil, in the surface soil. And during that time, 30 to 50% of the stubble decomposed if you measure decomposition on weight or amount of carbon. So the nitrogen is still in different pools. And you can see at the end of the first year, 45% of nitrogen we could measure that's in the soil still, out of which 30% or so in the stubble. But we still couldn't in the top, in this case, 60 centimeters, we couldn't measure that rest of the N. We couldn't find it. At Karoonda, leaching of that amount is unlikely to happen based on rainfall. And if you go to the next year again, around 7 to 10% of the stubble from the previous year is still around in the stubble, that is semi-decomposed stubble. And at the end of the second crop, so at the end of the first crop, 5% of the stubble nitrogen was taken out by the crop. At the end of the second crop, 3.5% of the nitrogen of the 2014 is taken up. So a total of 8.5% of nitrogen from a 2014 stubble is taken up by the next two crops. 8.5% looks good because it says, oh, 10% of, but that is 10% of the 12 kilograms. So you're only getting around 1 to 2 kilos after 2 years. So one of the results of this is that in this environment, between around 2.5, 3 tons of cereal stubble regions, cereal stubble is not a direct source of nitrogen. So that is a, we could solidly tell that because it is followed through this N15 labeled nitrogen. So how does stubble affect nitrogen availability, nitrogen things? Just to compare, we'll go to Horsham, which is a heavy clay soil, you know, a little higher organic matter and 5 to 8 tons of crops. So first you look at it, in Horsham there was only 30% of fertilizer nitrogen use efficiency in the first year. So 70% of nitrogen applied wasn't taken up. And 32 kilograms of N went through the stubble. So if you just look at 32 kilograms of nitrogen, you say, if I need 80 kilos, I have 30 kilos coming through stubble. But after, of course, decile 1 year, it's only around 1 kilogram of that 32 kilograms is taken up by the crop. And after the second year, another 3 to 4 kilos. So total is around 5 kilograms of the 32 kilos was taken up in the next two crops. Once again, the proportion of nitrogen that is from the stubble going through the next two crops is small. So once again, and if you look at that as percentage, like as I said before, 2 to 3% of stubble N is found in the next crop, and 11% stubble nitrogen found in the second crop. The reason why higher in the second crop in Horsham is decile 1 and then decile 10. And there was a time for stubble nitrogen to go through microbes and come through, so that's one of the reasons why in the second year that's higher. At Tamura, where they had a good rainfall every year, again it is not like that. It is still 5 to 6% in the first year, and so up to 8%, depending upon how stubble was maintained, and then 5% in the second. So overall, stubble only contributed around 10% of the stubble end contributed to the requirement of that. And at the end of the second year, in theory, there is 60% of the nitrogen from the stubble, 2014 stubble, is still in the soil. That's because that's the blue numbers, is because some of those amount of nitrogen left after second year crop, we are still analyzing. We are going down to 1 meter profile, like Andy asked, to see can we actually find where is it gone. As in the, at Karoonda, it's unlikely it is denitrified because there's not much rain. But at Horsham, decile 10 year could have been 3 to 4 kilos would have been denitrified and gone up. So that's the story for the top. You might say, how does it apply to this part of the country? We saw from LIDA work that, again, fertilizer nitrogen efficiency is less. We know decomposition rates in this environment, rates of wheat stubble, we did that 10, 15 years ago with Nigel, which are quite similar between Karoonda and Horsham. So it's unlikely, most likely, cereal stubble nitrogen contributes to less than 10% to the next crop. So nitrogen taken up as a nitrogen source from a cereal stubble is quite low. I talked before about nitrogen is in different pools. and that nitrogen has to go through these pools before it is available to plants or it is lost. So can we also able to quantify these different pools and compare that to the nitrogen that is taken up by a crop? And so if you look at that diagram there, and you will see nitrogen in microbial pools is around 18 to 27 kilos, depending upon stubble retained systems, stubble removed systems, and that way. Nitrogen in mineral N in the profile at the sowing, that ranges between 30 to 50. And we know that nitrogen fertilizer we put in is 20 kilos, but only 8 kilos or so is available to crop. So we're putting 20 kilos. So if you just go on that, nitrogen from soil organic matter decomposition and microbial turnover, which is what we're looking for, we estimate around 26 to 39 kilos, that is nitrogen supply potential. Only when we consider that nitrogen supply potential by considering microbial turnover, we were able to explain that around 40, 45 kilograms of nitrogen taken up by the crop. So if you look at that way, nitrogen supply potential, that is microbial turnover from organic matter and crop residues, overall contributes more than 50% of the crop N taken up. This result is actually previously also John Angus and a few others in the research have shown that nitrogen from soil organic matter and old residues contributes more than 50%, at least 50% of the crop N requirement in most over the East, which is what we see here also. And if you look at a similar one, and more stark contrast you can see at Horsham. So in at Karunda, you can see microbial nitrogen is 18 to 27 kilos. At Horsham, it's around 120 kilos because of heavy clay soil and that previous organic matter there. But we only applied 29.5 kilos of fertilizer nitrogen. The reason we applied less is because we knew about this organic matter capacity supply, and Claire Brown kept calling me, "Gupta, we are not applying enough. We are expecting decile 10. Need to apply lots of amount." So it's experimental plots. Let's have a look and see, does this nitrogen supply potential provide an indication of soil's ability to supply? And they did have other trials nearby where they did apply higher fertilizer. And you can see, because of the high nitrogen supply potential, that's microbiology providing that, you can see that microbial turnover related nitrogen supply contributed quite significantly to the amount of nitrogen taken up by the 5 to 6 tons of crop. So by following different pools, another take home message is that we were able to establish that in these two systems, and similar story at Tamora in New South Wales, that in these three systems, that the contribution of stubble to nitrogen cycling is through modifying microbiology and these processes, not as a direct source of nitrogen. And so what happens when you burn the stubble? So now, as you know, that 2015 December, there was fire in close to Adelaide, in the Pinery fires. So Peter Trelaw had a couple of fields that he sampled for doing some mineral nitrogen. So we went and measured some of these pools. Only look at that, don't worry about this graph. And you can see what happens to burnt and stubble microbial biomass nitrogen. And so removal of stubble that way, one of the main things that happens first is that the nitrogen in microbiology, and of course microbial activity also is reduced. It's that microbial turnover that is reduced. So it's a one-off burn in that situation that happened. So stubble is a source of carbon for microbial activity and growth, which in turn affects nitrogen availability. And a few years ago, you also had a big fire around here. So another point, how does this nitrogen supply potential indicate what happens to nitrogen mineralization in crop? So does the nitrogen mineralization at seeding time, which is dependent upon crop residues and everything, would it maintain in different stubble retained systems as crop grows? So we measured nitrogen mineralization. Nitrogen mineralization in the field next to the rows. And you may see that red blob on the top there. So all you have to look in this graph is those bars from left to right, from September to November. And you see, as the season progresses, nitrogen mineralization potential, nitrogen mineralization in the field actually reduces. For the reasons, one, you can expect crop residue is decomposing, therefore nitrogen mineralization is reduced. Two, as the season progresses in raised fence systems, soil moisture is going down. But if you look at the bars under different stubble management systems, the trend still remains. So in-season mineralization is influenced by the background soil organic matter, but more importantly, in this part of the world, at Karunda, the rainfall and temperature. So I went and looked at microbial biomass and mineralization in different soils and different environments. And you can see the range. And the reason I put this slide is there are two numbers there, Streaky Bay and Minipa. And you can see nitrogen supply potential. It ranges between as low as 20 to 60 kilos nitrogen. This is a Minipa experimental site and a Streaky Bay calcareous soils. But another aspect this microbiology does is immobilization or tie-up potential. Microorganisms can effectively take up nitrogen applied in fertilizer and tie up them, and that is quite common in cereal residue retained systems. So when your fertilizer is applied, the fertilizer is initially taken up by microbes, majority of it, because during that time that you have seedling growth slow and the demand is low. So that's another aspect in this. Now cereal residue retention is a common practice. Another aspect that you need to consider when you are applying fertilizer and fertilizer requirement that you estimated before, that in cereal stubble retained systems, especially if summer rainfall is below average, then stubble provides a significant that tie-up potential. So that's another aspect you need to consider. And this nitrogen supply potential, the difference between nitrogen supply potential estimates based on including microbial turnover compared to just nitrogen mineralization from organic matter, you can see from this one. So there are two parts of the table, the first year and the second year effects. That is, we were looking at crop rotation effects. If you estimate nitrogen supply, nitrogen mineralization based on organic carbon only, in those 3 years or 4 year rotations, organic carbon did not change. But if you measure nitrogen supply potential, you considering microbial turnover as part of it, then you can see there's between 10 kilos to 20 kilo difference between the rotations. And using this nitrogen supply potential estimate, Theresa McMath is going to explain, match with the nitrogen taken up, nitrogen yield by the crop. So estimating nitrogen supply potential by considering microbial turnover as part of the estimation provides a better estimate of nitrogen supply capacity. I suppose that helps better target nitrogen supply potential, nitrogen application. So that's a summary where cereal stubble contributes less than 10%, and stubble retention effects mostly through microbiology are changing biological turnover. And cereal stubble mostly provides that mineralization but also immobilization potential. Fertilizers use efficiency is less than 50%. So this is all that came through that stubble project of a 2-3 years of work. What Theresa McMath with Andy Weir and many others has done is they looked at nitrogen use efficiency in stubble retained systems. The aim of that component was to measure nitrogen supply potential and different soil and residue combinations and to estimate nitrogen use efficiency in the lower EP as a part of the LEADER project. And they measured this, estimated or calculated nitrogen efficiency using this formula where they measured nitrogen supply potential, they measured mineral N, fertilizer nitrogen, and grain yield and grain nitrogen. And what they found is that nitrogen use efficiency ranged as low as 12% to 68% in these different environments. And there are three examples. I don't want to go through everything else. One was at Lincoln, Mount Hill Sand, and Cummins. At all three sites, you see nitrogen use efficiency is many of them less than 50% for various number of reasons. The site that actually you had higher, that is at Cummins site, because of microbial turnover is measured, we could see the high efficiency there is because of that high nitrogen supply potential, that's the middle number 80 and 65, and also what she called high functioning microbial turnover. Because you accelerated that microbial turnover, that nitrogen going from stubble and organic matter through microbiology, there is higher nitrogen use efficiency. And the system on the top, which is at a Lincoln systems, nitrogen supply potential is high, but some other soil constraints led to lower nitrogen efficiency. So her conclusion was this, that soil specific N may be the one that needs to be considered, and more thorough evaluation of in-season nitrogen strategies. So considering nitrogen turnover through microbial turnover is one of the ways that you can actually estimate the nitrogen use efficiency in a system and use that as a means to design or change your fertilizer strategies.